wonderful. You are a child of God. You are made in His image. You are powerful and mighty through Him. You are the children of God today. You are wise and smart. You give Him your best. You are more than conquerors. And in your heart and in your lives, He is magnified and glorified today. In your lives and in your hearts, He is King, King of all and King of your life. Remember today, all that He's done for you, all that He's doing for you, and all that is going to be accomplished through you as you yield your life and your heart to Him. You are His child. Remember today, you are the child of the King. You are the child of the King. Listen to that. You are the child of the King. The King of glory. The King of this earth. The King of the heavenly realms. The King of all things today. You are His child. And nothing shall be denied you as you put your faith and your trust in your hand, in His hand, and walk with Him upon this earth, and walk with Him where He desires you to walk. He will give you all things. He will provide all things. He will make a way where there seems to be no way. He will fill your heart and your life with the manna from heaven, so that you might be nourished, so that you might be strengthened, so that you might be empowered to walk in His glory and walk in His might. And you will not miss a beat, because God will be there walking with you, taking you from this place to the next place, to the next place, as we put our faith and trust in the King of glory, the Lord of heaven today. Let's give Him a round of applause and praise for what He's doing in our lives and doing in our hearts today. Thank you, Father, for being in this place. Thank you, Father, for being Father, the substitute in our lives for our lack. Father, for being strength in our weakness. Father, for being the wisdom of heaven. Lord God, in our lack of wisdom. Thank you, Father, for meeting all of our needs according to your riches in glory. According to your riches in glory. Look in your pocket today. Look in your purse or in your wallet and see the riches of God. See the riches of God. Don't let your lack of faith take from you that which God has given you by your divine right as a child of God. Look in your wallet, look in your purse, and see the riches of glory. See God's provision. See God's grace. Don't see your lack. Don't see what you lack, but see what God has given you by His power and by His glory. Let's not be defeated today or brought down by our own lack of faith or belief in a God that holds all things in the palm of His hand. But let us look in the Word of God, which is our strength, which is our bread of life, which sustains us. And let's see the promises of God. Do you understand that your promise is but a page away? The page of the Bible, the page of your promise, the page that God has promised in your life and in your heart, whatever you lack today, God has provision for you to minister in your life. It's the manna from heaven. It's the riches of heaven. It's the Holy Spirit. It's the provision that God... You know what you have to do sometimes? You have to look at what isn't and say it is by faith. Trusting God. Why else did He give us these promises? He didn't give us the promises so that we might not take them and apply them in our lives, but He gave us the promises so that we might walk in faith and in power and in strength, so that we might defeat every enemy that comes against us, so that we might be many mighty men and women of God, destroying the works of the enemy, walking in faith, walking in His provision. There's nothing impossible to Him. Nothing impossible. Nothing. Whatever you have need of today, God has it, and He wants to give it to us. We're told in Scripture that we as men, we know how to give good gifts. How much more? How much more will our Heavenly Father give good gifts unto those that love Him? Every good gift. Every good, you know, sometimes we just don't think it's for us. We don't think it's ours. We get cheated out of it sometimes. We get cheated out of the blessings and the power of God. Today, the Lord wants to remind us and establish in each and every one of us that He knows your need. He knows what you have need of today. And He wants to take it right now from His storeroom in the heavenlies. Take it off the shelf and give it to you. Trust Him. Believe Him. Realize today that He has what you have need of in your life. Find strength in Him. Find strength in His presence. Let's just continue to worship the Lord. As you turn in your Bibles to Judges chapter 6, verses 11 through 24. Judges chapter 6, verses 11 through 24. Thank you, praise team. You do a wonderful, awesome, powerful job. We just praise the Lord. As a matter of fact, today we're going to be looking at, in Scripture, a man, his name was Gideon. And Gideon is kind of a study in contrast. On the one hand, he was a man, if you remember in the Bible, he was a man that led a handful of warriors, 300 warriors, against a large army and won the victory. And on the other hand, Gideon was filled with doubts, fears, and questions. He was a man who questions God's plan for his life. Yet, he did God's will. Sometimes in our lives, you know, we look at it's hard to explain, but we look at ourselves and we go, can God really use me? Can God really work through me? Can God's presence and His power, I don't know what it is, but I think we all kind of think that way at times, don't we? Can I see a hand of feet? I mean, a raise of hands and a shouting with your feet, whatever. Praise the Lord. But you know what I mean? We kind of doubt ourselves, but just like Gideon, he was called to be a judge during this time of Israel. The nation was suffering from the grip of the Midianites' oppression upon their lives. They watched helplessly as their land was stripped away from them, as things were taken from them and their villages were destroyed. As a matter of fact, their condition is summed up in verse 6, and it says that they were impoverished. The word literally means at the end of their rope. They were at the end of their rope. They were impoverished by what was happening around them. Israel's main problem at this point was that they counted God out. We can't count God out of what is happening in our lives, but we have to remember who we serve, that He is powerful and that He is mighty and His grace is ready to be bestowed upon us so that we might be strengthened, so that we might be renewed. But you know, God always has a message, and God always has a man. And he, matter of fact, sometimes, you know, he has more than, you know, the message and men that will do what God has called them to do. I believe that this is a group of people that are doing what God has called them to do, that have desired in their hearts and have planted in their hearts the faith to believe and then the faith to walk out the walk of faith. There's great faith and there's great provision and there's great priority of God's presence in this house and in this body of believers. God is here to do a mighty and a powerful thing, but there's times when he takes us from one point to the next point. Let's look at verse 11. Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the terebinth tree, which was in Ophrah, which belonged to Joash, the Abrazinite, right? And woo, I do not know why they name these things like that. But anyways, while his son Gideon threshed wheat in the winepress in order to hide it from the Midianites, this verse reveals the condition of Israel. It was a time of poverty. We see that Israel was kind of going through some dark times and desperate days. And it's made clear in these verses. Evidently, Gideon and his family had been able to hide away a small amount of wheat. And they were hiding behind the wine press, threshing the wheat, making it ready for flour and for bread. Now, wheat was normally laid on the ground in the olden days, and actually up a lot of times up on the mountain where there's a lot of wind, and they would take that wheat and they'd throw it up, and the chaff would kind of blow away and the seeds would fall to the ground. That's how they worked their wheat. But we see here in this verse that Gideon was at the threshing floor, and he was preparing that wheat by hand. We actually see it's by hand and not necessarily by some of the other techniques that they had back in those days. But we find Gideon thrashing grain by hand, and it indicates that it was actually a time of poverty that the Israelites were going through, and it was also a time of persecution. Gideon was hiding behind the wine press, trying not to be seen because he knew the Midianites were out there, and their villages were being destroyed, and it was a time of powerlessness. This is seen in the fact that he was hiding from the enemy. He was just as defeated and just as frightened as the rest of the nation. But let me encourage you today. I'm trying my best to encourage you folks today, believing that God is wanting us to be encouraged and to be strengthened. There's times when we all face difficult times. We all go through difficulties and challenges in life. It's just the way it is. We have to sometimes go through the threshing floor, right? The Israelites at this time were living in days when the government and society in general was growing increasingly hostile to the things of the Lord. We're actually living in the same time where things just seem to get more and more hostile against believers, and we're kind of told that in the Bible. We're kind of forewarned in the Bible that will happen in the end times. That, you know, that we have to be ready. We have to be, you know, ready for what, you know, is going to happen in the end times. But God is using these end times to raise up a bride that is spotless and white. And he's preparing his people and preparing his children to be a witness, to be his glory and his presence on this earth. But Gideon was hiding from the enemy. But you know what? God or the Lord knew exactly where Gideon was. In verse 12 it says, "And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, 'The Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor.'" Now look at here. First off, we see here that the angel of the Lord appeared. Now, we know here that the angel of the Lord is actually a theophany or a Christophany, where the Lord appeared in the Old Testament times. And actually, the terebinth tree or the oak tree was a lot of times a symbol of where there was theophanies or where Christ appeared in the Old Testament times. And it says the
angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon. And it said, he said to him, "You mighty man of valor." So here was Gideon. He was hiding behind the wine press. He was hiding, and in his own heart, he knew he didn't have what God, you know, wanted him to have. But the Lord comes down and he says, "You mighty man of valor." You know, God sees you and he sees me for what we will become, not for what we are. See, the Lord looketh on the heart, but man looketh on the outward appearance. And God doesn't always choose those individuals that we think he should choose or use, right? In our own estimation, we think, yeah, the Lord ought to use that man over there that's 15 feet tall. You know, appearance, just like they did with Saul. He was a stature ahead above everyone else. That's who the Israelites chose. They chose a very tall man, and in their eyes, he looked, you know, he looked like he was the individual that God would use. You see, God looks at the heart. And he said to Gideon, "You man of valor." Even before Gideon had done anything, God is already calling him a man of valor. And it's the same thing in our lives. God calls you wonderful. God calls you his child. God calls you, you know, the gifts of heaven. God calls you more than a conqueror. You men and women of valor. The Lord is with thee. And it literally means, when he was talking to Gideon, it literally means his power is on you. The Lord's power today is on you and is using you and is strengthening you. Romans 8 and 11 says, "But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you." Today, in each and every one of us as believers, the Spirit of God dwells in us. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead. He lives with you. Do you say that with me? He lives in me. The Spirit lives in me. It says right here, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, he also dwelleth in you. So do you realize you have the same Spirit in you that has the power to heal? I mean, it's the Lord, but he's using you through you to raise the dead, to feed the poor. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, he lives in us. It says in the Bible that the same Spirit is working in us. The Spirit in us. That same Spirit is working in us and living in us. Now the Lord says something here totally and truly amazing. Again, he calls him a mighty man of valor. And that actually means a man who is charging right into the face of the enemy. So here's Gideon. We know the story about how he, with 300 men, destroyed a large army. But again, God is looking at the heart of Gideon. You know, the Lord knows you better than you know yourself. If you're like me, a lot of times you look at your mistakes, your failures, and your problems in life, and you try to summarize and say, how can the Lord use me? It's because we look at our problems. We look at, you know, our mistakes. We look at the things that the problems. You know, we all have problems, right? We all face issues and problems in life. But that's where faith and trust comes in. When we have faith in God's Word and faith in what God is telling us to do and promising in our lives, that we're able to overcome our mistakes, that we're able to overcome our failures, that we're able to overcome our problems. Because we all have them. Every one of us have problems. All of us have made mistakes. But we can't focus upon the problems. We can't focus upon our past life. We can't focus of what we've done in our past.
Because we'll never be used of God if we continue to allow the past to control our future. We have to allow God's future to control us. Because when you ask Jesus Christ into your heart and into your life, you became a new creation. You became a new person. You became His child. And you became the one that shouts and says, "My God is able. He has delivered me. He has made me into His image. I am no longer the same." That old Warren that existed a long time ago is no more. But I am now a child of God, and I am able to do through His help and through His strength that which He has called me to do. And He's speaking to our hearts today to allow Him to take you to the place that He wants to take you. Don't be discouraged. Don't be downtrodden by your own weaknesses. Don't let your weaknesses take you down, because they can if you allow them to. You can ponder upon them, and you can think about your past, and you can think about your failures. But that's not how God sees you. He sees you as a mighty man and woman of God. Because He knows your heart. He knows you better than you know yourself. That's why He's able to use the weak, the impoverished, and do the impossible. He desires us. We're going to see here in a minute. The only thing, one thing God desires. And when we do that, when we give Him that, look out. When we allow Him and His power and His presence. I think that clock is off. It says 5 to 12. I did not believe that. What did God see in Gideon? Well, let's look at verse 13. Gideon said to him, "Oh my Lord, and if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all His miracles which our father told us about, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt?' But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites." So Gideon begins to question God's presence. Gideon wants to know and wants proof that God's presence can be found. If God was really with His people, he's saying in his heart, shouldn't they be experiencing victory instead of defeat? He questions God's performance. Gideon wants to know where all the miracles have gone. It had been 250 years since they were delivered from the land of Egypt through the devastating plagues. And then he questions God's perception. When the Lord hears Gideon questions, he responds by telling him that He will indeed save Israel. I'm reminded of this individual that was drowning at sea. And he started praying, "Oh Lord, help me. I'm drowning. I need help." And the next thing you know, the plane was flying over, actually really low. But the man thought, "No, that can't be for me. That's not it. So he continued to pray, Oh Lord. Save me, I'm drowning." Next thing you know, a ship comes by. And it was close enough, he could have yelled out. And he goes, "No, that's not for me." Continue. It's the same thing in our lives. We pray sometimes and the answer comes, but we don't recognize it. Sometimes it's not what we want, but God is answering our prayers. And God was here with Gideon. Let's look at verse 14. "Then the Lord turned to him and said, 'Go in this might of yours, and you shall save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have I not sent you?' So he said to him, 'Oh my Lord, how can I save Israel? Indeed, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house.'" Gideon's response to the question was to question the Lord's omniscience. I need a drink here. He tells the Lord that he can't be right. He tells the Lord that he can't be the deliverer because his father's house was poor and no one would follow him.
As a matter of fact, in his father's house, no one respected him. A lot of us are like Gideon. We know the Lord wants us to be used of him by his power and his might, but we're looking at our past. We're looking at the tools that we have, or the family that we have, or the things that we've grown up with. Well, that's not what is important to God. We're going to find here in a minute what's important. Matter of fact, there was a member of a motorcycle gang who was converted to Christ. And the first Sunday after he was converted, he showed up to church. Now, this was a big, burly man, you know, with tattoos and, I guess, a do-rag. I guess that's what they call him, a do-rag. And, you know, he just come walking in and he sits down. And the pastor's up there starting to say, "We need nursery workers. Anybody wants to work in the nursery? You know, we need nursery workers really bad." No one responded. So he goes, "We need nursery workers." The second time. Actually, we do. But anyways. And the big burly guy, the motorcycle guy, he said, "Lord, if he says it one more time, I'll go do it. Because I know that I'm supposed to do something for you." So the pastor goes, "We need nursery workers." Next thing you know, the big old burly guy stands up and says, "I'll do it, Pastor." And he starts walking towards the nursery. Guess what? All of a sudden, 50 women got up and went towards the nursery. That's one way to get nursery. No. But you know, it doesn't matter. A lot of times, you know, when we first get saved, or a lot of times we're more ready to serve the Lord or anxious to serve the Lord than as time passes by. But you know, again, God uses people that we don't expect him to use. He uses all types of different people. He actually even wants to use you. And he is using you. But he wants us to continue to grow in that strength and in that provision. Let's look at a few people that God used. He used Jacob, who was a liar, to be the father of the nation of Israel. He used Joseph, a slave, to save the world. He used Moses, a shepherd, and a murderer, to deliver his people. He used Jephthah, the son of a prostitute, to deliver Israel. He used an unnamed servant girl to tell Nahum about God. He used Esther, a slave, to deliver Israel. Matthew, a tax collector, to write about Jesus, the King of Jews. Saul of Tarsus, to write about over one half the New Testament. Can God use you? Certainly he can. But we can't allow our past, our problems, and our failures to get in the way. Let's look at verse 16. "And the Lord said to him, 'Surely I will be with you, and you shall defeat the Midianites as one man.'" Here the Lord confirms the call upon Gideon. He tells Gideon that he will be able to destroy the Midianites as one man. Remember, with God, nothing is impossible. What seems impossible to us, we're one person, but God can take one man and destroy a whole army, right? Because it is through his strength and through his presence and through his power. Now Gideon continued to kind of, you know, still wasn't quite sure that, you know, God was calling him to do this. So he petitioned the Lord a little bit more and wanted to ask a few things. Sometimes we do the same thing. "Well, Lord, if this is really you, you know, how about this happens or this happens?" We do it. I mean, sometimes we want to make sure that it's the Lord, right? So here was Gideon in verses 18 through 21, and he says, "Do not part from here, I pray, until I come to you and bring out my offering and set it before you." So the angel of the Lord said, "I'll wait until you get back." So Gideon went, and he prepared a young goat and unleavened bread, actually like 35 pounds of bread. So kind of here we start to see Gideon's life and his faith change. Here he's going to give away a lot, you know, a sacrifice that cost a lot for him. They were in poverty. So then the angel of the Lord put out the end of the staff in verse 21 that was in his hand, and he touched the meat and unleavened bread, and the fire rose out of the rock and consumed the meat and the unleavened bread, and the angel of the Lord departed out of his sight. Thank the Lord we have a patient Lord that, you know, in our weaknesses, we continue to ask for signs or ask for, you know, is this really you? He is patient and he does help us along. But Gideon made an offering to the Lord, which means a present. The Lord promised to wait for Gideon. He did. And it's amazing to see what the Lord did. He touched the sacrifice with the staff, and it was consumed. So God, here God is saying, I accept you. I accept your sacrifice, and I accept, you know, what is going to happen. Let's look at Romans 12, verses 1 through 2. It says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living, holy sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So here the Lord is beseeching us by the mercies of God that we would present ourselves a sacrifice acceptable to God, which is our reasonable service. These verses here tell us that by completely yielding ourselves to the Lord, we'll be able to recognize His will, which is good, acceptable, and perfect. You catch what that's saying? Knowing the will of, you want to know the will of the Lord in our lives, in your life? It's as simple as yielding yourself to Him. If you want to know God's will for your life, simply yield to Him. Now, we yield to Him when we give our heart to Him as Lord and Savior of our life. But there's also other times when He's calling us or speaking to us specifically to go and do a task or go and do what He has called us to do. And again, sometimes we kick against that and we struggle with it. Lord, should I really be doing this? Should I really be moving in this direction? But we can simply know the will of our Father. And also we can experience this, that if we yield ourselves to the will of God, then we can know assuredly that it will not be by our might or by our strength that that task is accomplished, but it will be His strength and His provision. He's simply asking us to put ourselves on the altar of sacrifice, and then He'll do what He's called you to do. Not us. He's simply looking for, because we don't have the ability or the strength to do things that He calls us to do. But He's simply wanting us to lay ourselves on the altar of sacrifice, yielding ourselves to Him, and then He will accomplish it. So you don't even have to worry about the accomplishment of the task, because it's Him that will accomplish it, not us. Now, we're used of Him, we're led of Him, but we don't have to worry about the details of what He calls us to do when we put our faith and our trust in Him. When we say, yes, Lord, send me. Yes, Lord, I hear your call. Yes, Lord. And here Gideon, he builds an altar and he worships the Lord. As a matter of fact, that altar is called Jehovah Shalom, or Lord of our peace. Gideon found peace in submission and worship. When he submitted to the Lord's will for his life, when he fell before the Lord in humble worship, Gideon found a place of comfort and of strength. That will still work today. If you want peace, joy, and happiness, you'll find it as you surround yourself in the will of the Lord. Until we do what the Lord wants us to do, seriously, until you do, you know, what the Lord wants us to do, it can become difficult to have true peace. I remember the story of Jonah. You know, he thought he could outrun God, and you know, we know the story where God's, you know, he's swallowed by a whale. So Jonah would have a little time to reflect, you know, upon his decisions. is probably, I don't know what it would be like inside a whale, but I don't think it would be pretty. I don't think it would be a good time. It might be a good time to reflect upon, you know, what the Lord is asking you to do, but you know what I'm saying. We have to be, you know, open to God's will and God's presence and God's power. Let's all stand today. So just looking on the outside, it doesn't look like Gideon will amount to much in the Lord's work. He's fearful, he's timid, he's filled with self-doubt. He has more questions than he has answers. However, Gideon is being brought to a place of service. The Lord is willing to take Gideon just like he is and shape him to what he wants him to be. So again, the Lord is simply asking us to be available. I don't know if you've ever heard of the Pareto principle or the 20% principle, but you know, it's said that 20% of the people in church do all of the work, do 100% of the work. And I think, you know, the Lord wants us to turn that around, where 80% of the people do all of the work. We all have the ability to yield ourselves to Him. And then God is able to take, we do have gifts, we do have abilities, then He's able to take, you know, the things that He has gifted us with and use for His glory. There's always a place and there's always an opportunity to serve in the church. We believe that, you know, we're all called to be ministers. We're all called to be used of God. And you know, to be honest, if you're not doing something in the church, if you're not being busy about the Lord's business, people can tend to drift away and drift out of church, drift away and out of the body, and we don't want that. We want everyone to have a place or an opportunity to serve, and we encourage that. Don't think that, you know, we don't want your help, because we do. But there's always a place, and we have opportunities. I believe even today that, for instance, some of the praise team went down and worked with the nursery to help out there. But and I also want to say I want to thank everyone for, you know, for helping out and their diligence, and I want to thank you, you know, from when we've started until now, and the people that are helping out and are stepping up and, you know, are helping out and what God is doing. I want to encourage you, because you're awesome. You've done a wonderful job. But I want to encourage you, those that might have been, you know, tossing that around in their minds, is there a place for me to serve? The answer is a resounding yes. There's opportunity and a place. But if you don't feel worthy enough, remember that Jesus used a bunch of flawed people to share hope with a flawed world. In Him we find renewal and mending in His strength. Let's just go before the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank You today, Father, for Your presence, Your power, and Your glory in this place. Father, continue to speak to Your people and minister in their lives. Father, we just continue to pray that they would be filled, Lord God, today to up and to overflowing with Your strength and Your provision. Father, their hearts are, Lord, after Your heart. Father, their desire is to serve You. Their desire is to worship You. Father, and we thank You for them. They're, Father, wonderful. Father, they're excellent. They're excellent servants of You. We thank and praise You, Father, for their lives, and we ask You just to guide them and direct them and speak to them today. We give You the praise and the glory and the honor. If there's anyone here today that would like to say, yes, I want to take the next step in what God is speaking to me, and maybe I've felt that God couldn't use me, or
Maybe because of my past or my flaws or whatever it might be, remember that we've all gone through that. We've all experienced that. But the Lord might be speaking to your heart today. If you'd like us to pray for you, we're just going to open the altars for a few minutes as we ask the Lord to minister in your life and in your heart. The altars are open at this time. We'd love to pray with you.
Surrender, Father. strength.